Welcome back to the Wintry Wyvern. Halloween came early this year as Wizards of the Coast just released a new Unearthed Arcana called Gothic Lineages, featuring the ever-popular vampire bloodkin the Dampier, the Hexblood, one born of a hag's magic, and the Reborn, a second self with a new lease at life. There's a few things really special about this UA. It's the first content release of 2021, and the first Unearthed Arcana following in the footsteps of Tasha's Cauldron of Everything, and quite possibly redefining how races will be released for the indefinite future. There's timestamps below if you want to skip around, so let's dive in, shall we? The date is January 26th, 2021. Gothic Lineages is the name of the document, quite possibly a callback to the Gothic Heroes Unearthed Arcana, released all the way back in 2016. Gothic Heroes featured the Revenant subrace. The Revenant represented a character that had perished sometime during their journey, and returned to life with a mission to complete what it had left behind. Bonuses included a constant regeneration of HP, revival every 24 hours, and an uncanny tracking sense of the goal in mind. Your life would end when your mission was complete, unable to be revived. In the new Gothic Lineages document, we see the same themes touched upon. Individuals irreconcilably changed, with shadowy forces at play. At the top of the UA, they've now included the co-authors of the document. The name that stands out here is F. Wesley Schneider, co-creator of the popular Pathfinder RPG, and writer of adventures 7 Days to the Grave, Rule of Fear, Classic Horrors Revisited, and Pathfinder Tales Bloodbound, all stories handling gothic horror. Although he's worked on a number of UA leading up to Tasha's, his credit is definitely an important one for this release. Right at the start, this UA begins differently than most. It reads, "These options are special. You can choose one at character creation, or at an appropriate time later in the campaign, transforming your character." The Creating Your Character section details how you might have started off as an entirely different race, but upon taking on this lineage, you replace a great number of your traits with another. These races have no defined ability scores, outside of the +2 increase to one stat and +1 increase to another. This mirrors the design of custom lineages in Tasha's, where you can design your own race fitting to your DM's campaign setting. They are given 2 languages, common and any one other, as defined by what was likely your previous life. If you were transformed from another race to this lineage, you keep all your original languages and gain no new ones. The next section defines creature type. The great majority of playable races are humanoid, with few exceptions like the Fae Satyr and Centaur. Here they discuss having more than one creature type, and a new ruling. If an effect works on at least one of your creature types, it will work on you, regardless of your other types. Cure Wounds, for example, works on humanoids but not undead. This ruling permits it to work if you happen to be both. We've seen this before in the 2018 UA, Centaurs and Minotaurs. Both races were classified as human and monstrosity. This didn't stick in the official release, but it's interesting to see them take a second pass at the concept. The next note is a huge landmark in the sphere of D&D game design. Starting with this article, and including future D&D books, races will no longer have the ability score increase trait, language trait, alignment trait, and other cultural traits. Deciding that all of that is more likely determined by the circumstances of one's life, rather than their bloodline. Tasha's Custom Lineages has guidelines on how to handle ASI and languages, and alignment has largely fallen out of favor in terms of predisposition, recognizing that adventurers are, almost by definition, the exception from the norm. It's a pretty drastic move. Custom Lineages was largely considered and presented as optional to the D&D community, but here and now influences design philosophy beyond its paragraphs. I think it's a bold change, but not an unwelcome one. Specifically in this UA, where the lineages are quite literally formed from other races, it makes sense to have the ASIs and languages truly open-ended, depending on the character's history. How this affects more established races in D&D lore in the future, in future releases, we'll have to wait and see. Dampiers are the first on the list, and this very welcome addition might likely be the most homebrewed race in all of 5th edition. This official version speaks of the balance between the living and the dead, born of both worlds, struggling to stave off your dangerous cravings. You hold the power of a vampiric bloodline and its strengths. The first table is an awesome reference for hungers beyond the typical blood, offering strange and bizarre cravings like spinal fluid, humors like bile and phlegm, visual colors, and dreams. Even more so, they list out possible origins for your powers, ranging from vampire pacts, dark rituals gone wrong, and being an otherworldly entity slowly growing in power. Strangely enough, they didn't mention the rather popular Dampier backstory of Normal Mom, Vampire Dad, favoring more dramatic story threads. Regardless, let's get into the stats. Like we mentioned before, Dampiers get two creature types, humanoid and undead. Unfortunately enough, the undead tag does more harm than good, leaving you vulnerable to plenty of channel divinities, paladin smites, divine sense, and abjuration spells. There is a novel interaction with Oathbreaker Paladin, where you could be the victim of their control undead feature, or empowered by their aura of hate. The speed is nice, choice of medium or small makes sense if you started out as a smaller race, and dark vision is a given for vampires. Spider climb is very neat, being able to climb without hands at third level is a pretty funny visual. Vampire bite is just one more natural weapon tied to a race, but with a twist. You can add your con modifier to the attack and damage rolls, meaning it stacks with what I'm assuming is your strength modifier. The damage at the end of the day is still pretty paltry at higher levels, especially with limited uses per long rest. They've given it a few perks though. Attacking an advantage at half health is nice, regaining hit points equal to the bite damage, not all of the attack's damage, important distinction, and or a bonus to your next ability check or attack roll equal to that damage. The last feature I mentioned is novel, but I wouldn't be surprised if that and the healing were changed to a flat number in the official release, for the sake of simplicity. Overall, a pretty nice lineage. Vampires are such a fun thematic to lean into, and the origins lend themselves to some great long-term storytelling. The unique aspect of these is their accessibility mid-campaign, potentially transforming an already storied character into someone different yet familiar. We're gonna hold on to this idea leading into the next race, the Hexblood. Hexbloods are as edgy as they sound, this time tapping into the ancient magic of hags. Hags have been the queens of evil fae storytelling for many editions, and this is the first time in 5e players can tap into their magic without becoming a warlock or something. Players take on a foreign, twisted appearance of colored skin and wild hair, embodying the ancient magic they've taken on within themselves. The telltale sign of a Hexblood is an immovable crown that forms upon their head, symbolizing the bargain made with the corresponding hag. For some, this change is instant, a bold decision, but for others, it is a slow realization over time. There are even guidelines to turning into a hag, with consent of course, and plenty of ideas on how this blessing or affliction befell you. This is a far and welcome departure from the hag spawn, the all-male offspring of humans and hags, inheriting the looks and attitudes of their mothers but none of the talent. Again, it looks like Wizards is trying to avoid any implications of interspecies romances, at least in this doc. This time the dual type is fae and humanoid, a slightly less detrimental combination than undead. The fae's natural defenses against charms is seen in fae resilience, and hex magic represents a fragment of the hag's blessing. Being able to choose your spellcasting ability score is a new advent, usually they lock that to one specifically. Hex as a racial feature is really nice for those who don't want to dip into warlock for it, and about as thematic as it gets. Magic Token is a very fun ability that allows you to speak and see through one of your body clippings up to a distance of 10 miles away. Definitely not the most polished of magics, but again, perfect for the flavor. And it grows back, how neat. The Reborn is a familiar idea. We first saw it in 5e with the Revived Rogue, the original UA pitch for Tasha's before it became the Phantom Rogue. The Revived Rogue dealt with a character that survived death and retains a connection to the afterlife. Its major criticism at the time was its dissonance as a subclass. Would the player have to die at level 3 to unlock their first ability? Turning it into a race is a fantastic idea, retaining what was a plenty popular aesthetic, and allowing the flexibility of the transformation to occur at any level. The Reborn are manifestations of the undead turned living, or of magic and steel, with a foggy memory or a distant feeling of loss. They live on to complete themselves and understand if what they have become is truly what they seek. If anything, this lineage is designed for a gradual filling in of the blanks, a mostly empty canvas to be colored in piece by piece, revealing truths throughout your adventure. Reborns can be constructs or undead, the former finding some weaknesses to magic items designed for breaking constructs and the shatter spell. Deathless nature and knowledge from a past life is taken almost verbatim from the revived rogue and its features at 3rd and 13th level. Advantage on death saving throws is really, really good, with almost an 80% chance to succeed on every roll. There are plenty of similarities to the Warforged of Eberron, whom are only constructs by lore and not by stat block. All in all, I really like these. Not only are they mechanically unique, they lend themselves incredibly to a meaningful story that collaborates with a DM's imagination. The transformative lineages are a new concept to 5th edition, and it makes me wonder what plain touch races like Tieflings, Genasi, and Aesimar would look like if they were released today. They've also entirely left out the age detail from these races, although I can understand why their lifespans aren't exactly consistent. For me, I think the Hexblood and Reborn nailed the thematics and execution, while Dampiers might need a bit of tweaking to balance effectiveness and simplicity in that bite feature. I know plenty of people are hoping for a Ravenloft campaign, thanks to this arriving right next to the Spirit Bards and Undying Warlock, but with Wizards of the Coast planning to release an Innistrad expansion for Magic the Gathering this winter, a thematic also leaning heavily into Gothic horror, I can see them leaning more in that direction. Regardless, that's all for today. This is my first time doing a video on content so close to its release, so I hope it met expectations. May your Feyfolk bargains always be fairly made, your transformations always to your ultimate benefit, and above all, stay frosty.